Today is August 4th, 1997, and we're interviewing Joseph Morton. And the interviewer is Dan Gelfond. And this is taking place in Morton Grove, Illinois, in the United States, and the interview will take place in English. My name is Dan Gelfond, and I'll be interviewing Joseph Morton in Morton Grove, Illinois, in the United States, and today's date is August 4th, 1997. Can you please tell me your name and spell your name for me?
My name is Joseph Morton. It used to be Mortkowitz before it became Morton. As far as spelling the name, do you want the last?
Both of them.
Both of them. Joseph Morton is M-O-R-T-O-N. And before it would be Joseph Mortkowitz would be M-O-R-T-K-W-I-T-Z. And do you want my age?
Could you tell me your birth date and how old you are today?
Right now, I'm 73, and I was born in July 11, 1924.
Can you tell me the name of the city and spell that for me and tell me what country?
In Lodz, Poland.
How do you spell Lodz?
Lodz is L-O-D-Z.
Did you have any other Hebrew names or Yiddish names?
Well, Joseph is in Yiddish would be Yossel.
Can you tell me your father and mother's names and spell those for me?
My father's name was Haskell Mortkowitz, the same spelling what I just spelled, M-O-R-T-K-O-W-I-T-Z. And Haskell is C-H-A-L-S-L Haskell. That's about this.
What languages did your grandparents speak, or
well,
your parents?
We spoke Polish and Yiddish, and that's as far as we went.
Do you remember your grandparents' names?
Yes, my grandparents' names was Moshe Zalman. That's my grandfather. That's from my mother's side, and my grandmother was named Hannah Malka. And from my father's side, my grandfather's name was Yankiv, Jacob Mortkowitz. And my grandmother's name, if I recall correct, she didn't live too long. I was at a young age, which she wasn't alive anymore. So I really don't remember exactly her first name.
Did you have any brothers and sisters?
Yeah, we were six kids at home. Five brothers and one sister. And I was the oldest. And all the others were in line. You know?
Can you tell me their names from oldest?
From that's Abe, Abram, which he's alive, lives in Vegas. He used to live here in Skokie, but he moved to Vegas the last 3 years.
When was he born?
He was born in 1927, I think.
Where was he born?
Also in Lodz, Poland. And the youngest after my brother, was my sister, Sura Ruhl.
Can you spell her name?
Sura would be like Sarah, you know, S A R whatever, R E. I'm not that good in spelling. And
when was she born?
She was born, I would say roughly, and I was 27. She would have been probably about maybe 2 years younger, would come out to 29, 30, whatever. And then we had the next one was Shmulek. The same name, Mortkowitz. And he was born also about two and a half years in line. Which would be probably 30, or it's hard to remember exactly the dates. And we had one more was actually two more. His name was Sewer. Did I give you Shmulek that's now?
You have two more.
That was Laser Dovid, and the last one was Jacob. He was the youngest.
And when were they both born?
Shmulek was born. It's hard for me to remember exactly dates when he was born, but roughly I would go with two years apart, 2 or 3 years apart between the last two. So I don't know what year that would come out.
Did everybody?
They all were born in Lodz, Poland.
Did you share bedrooms with any of them?
No, we had the one bedroom, first the master bedroom. There was a living room and a kitchen. And that's the, as far as we had, we didn't have rooms like we had in nowadays, each kid had a bedroom.
So everybody slept in the same room?
The same room, yeah.
The parents and the six kids?
And the six kids.
Do you remember what that was like?
Crowded. It wasn't the best convenient area, but we managed. Somehow we managed.
Did you share beds with?
There was a couple beds. It was a nice size bedroom, which there were separate beds. And some of the little ones would sleep with their parents.
Do you remember your father and mother's jobs?
Yeah, my mother was, she didn't work. She took care of the kids and cooked and served the meals. And my father was the one who was the bread giver, working, tailoring.
He was a tailor?
Yeah.
Did he have his own store?
That wasn't a store. They manufactured merchandise, it's sort of like contracting. They took out work from a manufacturer and they manufactured the product, then delivered to the manufacturer.
Where you lived, was that a house or an apartment? Or
where we lived was it was an apartment. No, there was no house. It was an apartment. I would say roughly. They had 3, 6, 9. I would say about 12 apartments. And we would get together with the neighbors and the especially the kids as youngsters. We would tell each other stories in the evenings. At night, sitting on this shag, like youngsters, joke around and tell all kind of stories. We would get together. My aunt used to live in the same buildings, but on the main floor. We would always get together, and the neighbors and the family would always come to that particular place, and we always enjoying being with each other. Family in Europe weren't spread around that far like we live in here. We would go to each other and spend some time, dinners and holidays. It was a closeness. We really enjoyed each other.
What was the neighborhood like? Was it an all Jewish neighborhood?
The neighborhood we used to live in was considered all Jewish. The only Gentile people what I knew as a youngster would be the janitor, because we had to have somebody to come up for Saturday, light the stove, or in order to preheat a meal or whatever, because according to religion, you're not supposed to light the stoves or whatever, or put a light on. So the janitor, besides taking care of the area, the building on the inside and outside to the halls, she would do these things, and we sort of paid her by giving her some piece of holly or some candies or something in return for doing the service.
This was a woman?
Yeah, a woman, sometimes the daughter, but it's mostly a woman.
So you didn't have any non-Jewish friends at all?
Not that I can recall. The area where we lived was, matter of fact, they made the ghetto out in this sections because it was already concentrated as a Jewish section, and it wasn't the best looking areas, and the people from the rest of the area, from Lodge, was brought into this. They picked the section, which is it was a nice size section, and they created the ghetto in this particular area. So it was a Jewish section, which I don't remember having any Gentile friends or being together with them.
Did you go to a Jewish school?
I went to a public school. That's another thing. The school I went to, I don't recall ever being associated with a Gentile youth. So I don't know of any, but we were surrounded with them in the different sections. As a kid, we never would go to places where it would be more of a Gentile upbringing. But we were living between them, not with them.
So did you feel any anti-Semitism?
There was plenty. I remember they used to come in certain times and got a hold of some Jews. They used to wear the black, we used to call it kapatas, the black suits with the beards and the yittle, the Yiddish hetl that the Jewish hats, what they say. And they would kick them, tear their beards. The blood was running. And there was never police there to help out. They somehow stayed away. We used to call them the Andekas. It's like you would call the KK in here. They had a name. We called them the Andekas. And this would go on from time to time. As a kid, I recall all those incidents, which took up quite a bit. They also would go as far as to the Jewish area where we used to live, and they stopped right there because they knew if they go any further in, they would get punished for whatever they did. We would fight them back. We had plenty of Jewish guys which there could show their muscles and hit them back. And that was going on. As a kid, I remember all those incidents. There wasn't a picnic living with them together. So the association with them, I didn't do.
Do you remember your parents talking to you about anti-Semitism? Did they know non-Jewish people?
They knew some of them, but the ones we knew about, they didn't show it. So I can't really say anything about it, but it was a rough life. It was a life which it wasn't pleasant, and I wouldn't want to go through the same kind of life anymore, or any of our kids or any of our Jewish friends.
What were your earliest memories of school?
The school I remember as a youngster, first grade, second grade, the school where I used to go was close by in the neighborhood, not too far. And from over there...
Do you remember the name of the school?
I don't. They would send us back, send me actually to a different school, which it was a little bit of a distance. That's already going into the higher grades. And the walking distance, I would say roughly between 15 and 20 minutes of a walk. Or you could take a streetcar, which as a kid we never bothered. We figured the walking is good, which I still do walking. Going to the other school, that was on the, I remember the street and the number, but I just can't remember exactly the name of the school.
What was the address?
The address was Zavatska. I would know how to spell it, but I probably would. Z-A-W-A-Z-K-A, 42. That's as far as I can go. Going into my seventh grade, then when the interruption with the war, it stopped.
Did you also go to religious school at the same time?
We went to which was what called a cheder. Cheder, that's where you're being taught how to read and the prayings and also write Yiddish. There was no thing as having bar mitzvah parties, but you went, we went through the old procedure with laying the tefillin and everything, but no parties. And that was the Jewish Hebrew upbringing.
So did you have a bar mitzvah, but just?
I had in the shul a performance, you know, which said the prayers and everything, but at that time they just throw the candies at you, and that was it. And they had a sort of a luncheon get together in the house or a little bit in the shul. The shul where I used to go was also not far from, was almost the next building where we used to live. They would have it like it's a besmerish. It's a big room, maybe twice or three times the size what you see in here, and benches, and we would sit and pray. And I remember my grandfather, should rest in peace, he would do the praying from time to time as a baltwiller, which they do the praying, I'm sure. I don't know if you know what a baltwiller is. It's the guys who do the davening, you know, the in front of the Koron Oidish, and especially on the high holidays, he would do the performance.
Do you remember the rabbi's name there?
I hardly remember my name.
Did you celebrate Jewish holidays growing up?
Oh yeah, that when it comes to holidays or Shabbos, that was a must. We always celebrated, obeyed the Jewish religion, and I was brought up in a sort of orthodox behavior, which holidays, Shabbos, and even going sometimes the morning to the prayers, to the shul. To the besmerish, it was close by, and that's everybody knew everybody.
What were the holidays like? Did you celebrate at your house or your relatives?
We celebrated there in our house, and from time to time we went to celebrate with the rest of the families together. I remember it used to come in the evening, especially like on a Saturday night before sundown, we would get together to places where we sort of had a little tape player going, we would sort of entertain ourselves by singing, dancing a little bit. We used to have guys from the building there, which there, some of them used to be sort of like a jokers. They would entertain each other pretty well. So it was a closeness. It was a nice, close upbringing.
Who did the cooking?
Mother, who holds? Mother, aunts.
Do you remember what kinds of things they'd make on the holidays?
I know it was food. And tasty, too. You know, like for Shabbos, you would have the regular meals, fish, chopped liver. They used to make chont, which that they prepared on a Friday evening, and we brought it to the bakery, and it would cook through the night there, and sort of after they got through baking the challis and the breads, whatever, and then afterward they would put us what I just said, chont dish, and it would cook till Saturday. We would come home from the shul, and we would run over with your ticket, because you wouldn't pay any money for that, because you're not supposed to, and you paid in advance. So this way you just showed him the ticket, and that little ticket had the same ticket on that pot, what you brought it, that which I just said it called chulant, and we got it back, and we had a good meal with it. Also, we would, since we weren't allowed, according to religion, not to cook anything, we would go to the called so-called the mikveh, where they always had hot water at the time. You would go with your, we call it in Yiddish a chanyik, that's a tea kettle. They would fill you with hot water, and this is the same thing. We would paying in return, really some sugar, some challah, something where there's no money involved.
Do you remember who your friends were at the time?
I remember some of them. You want their names?
If you remember them.
I do remember one was Chaim, Lipsky, I don't know exactly their spelling, Kalmer, I don't know how you'd say it in English, Kalmer would be Carl, Tushinsky, not Tushinsky, Carl, all of a sudden I just knew his. Terkeltaub. It's with a T, I got almost confused. Terkeltaub, then I had Monique Jubek. We had a lot of friends, but it's hard going back, you know, you're talking about 60 some years back. It's not so easy to remember every little detail.
Do you remember what you did with them?
Like I said, we would go bike riding. We would go. They also had, besides having your bikes or whatever, they had places where they would rent you a bike in the area. It was a big circled field. We would ride around. You rent for an hour or so, and we would go together. We never took out the bikes and ride outside, like going out to the certain farm area or whatever. It was safer to spend the time inside that ring, and that was one thing. We used to go ice skating. Well, we did things which young boys or girls would do, get together and do. We weren't involved in like you have nowadays baseball or football. Over there it was known as soccer that we would play. It's really, the life was a little tougher than it's now, that I can say.
Did your parents ever take vacations?
I don't recall. That wasn't in the book like they say nowadays.
Do you remember them talking about Hitler's rise to power or hearing about things changing at all?
I was a kid at the time. I wasn't that old, but I remember the discussions. They would say what was going on during the 30s, where the Germans would do a lot of harm to the Jews in there. Matter of fact, we had my aunt, who used to live also in this same area and same building where we used to live, because I had two aunts living in the same building where we were living too. But one aunt, the one I'm talking about it now, she had a sister that was my mother's brother was married to the aunt. So she had a sister living in Berlin. And I remember in the 30s, I don't know if it was 33 or whatever, they kicked her out with, I think, two or three kids from Germany, from Berlin, and they came back to Lodz, Poland. And with all the things what was going on in Germany at the time, you know, where they were giving the Jews a rough time at the time, they didn't kill them at the time, but they saw what was going on with the Nazis there. They were trying to come to power, and when they came to power, they kicked them out. But with all that, she wanted still go back there, which she did. And she was there, I don't know, till maybe 1937. And they sent them back again to Poland. They sent her back, but her husband, I think, went to England. And then a couple years later, the war came out. She never went back. She couldn't go back anymore. And that was the end of her, too.
Do you remember being worried as things were changing, or did you not realize?
Worried. You know, when you're a kid, you don't think of those things. You hear stories telling what's going on, but it goes in, like they say, in one ear in, the other one out. When you're young, those things don't hit you that bad. You don't concentrate on it, that what could happen. Besides, we didn't realize that those things would happen. We had enough problem taking care of the problems in Lodz itself, with when they would come and try to beat you up from time to time.
Okay, we'll continue in a second. Interviewing Joseph Morton. When was the first real sign of danger that things really started changing in your neighborhood?
Are you talking before the war?
Before the war. Before when the you first, war. What was the first major change?
Well, as far as the change, that I couldn't say a change. That all the things what took place, that was going on till actually the Germans, when the Germans came in, you know, they themselves couldn't even tell who is a Jew and who isn't a Jew. But there are the Poles, some of them, they would point the finger at us and show who is actually a Jew. So the changes, there wasn't a change than it would whatever took care before.
So when did the Germans actually come into your town?
Well, the war started. Excuse me. The war started in September 39, 1939. And I think that the start was on a Wednesday. Friday, the Germans already marched in. 2 days later, you know, they were already marched in because they didn't have too much of a fight over there. So they took over at the area by us lodge. In 2 days, they were there. So right there, the minute they came in, that what was going on, the Poles would show the finger, thus is ein Jude, you know, which they couldn't tell. They didn't know between the Poles and the Jews who's the Jew, but some of them would point a finger. And that's when the problems already started, where they would come in, block off certain streets, and they would grab people. They took them away. We didn't know where. Some of them they tortured. I'm ashamed to say it. They would take him to places where they would have barrels of crap. I should say shit, and they put their faces in those barrels. And some of them they took away completely, which nobody knew where they went.
Did you see these things? Did you witness?
I didn't see it. Only what I was heard what they did to them. Right after that, my father happened to be in the army, in the Polish army, at the time during the war. And when the Germans came in, he was going towards the Russian front, in which he was captured in Russia as a prisoner. And he was in a camp there, in a lager, I don't know what number. So he was there, we didn't know. And when the Germans came in, we were six kids, and I was the oldest at that time. Naturally, there wasn't that much left to take care of the family. And at the same time, I happened to be the bread giver at the time. They made us come to work in the Polizei Presidium. That's an organization, it's a headquarter which they had certain theatrical performance for the SS. They also, it's like a secret police, you would say. Myself and my brother, Abe, and my cousin, Jacob Goldlust, all three of us, we had to report to them and do the work there, which slavery, we had to be on the floors, parquet floors, we had to keep all this clean. Whatever there had to be as far as keeping things clean, we did. And that was going on for a while, we were going there, till that was the beginning of when the war started, I would say a few days later. Also, when the Germans came in, they put up signs that we should come to market place where they had fruit vegetables. It's like a, what do you call it, flea market. And they had already hanging, I think, three or four guys to scare everybody off. Whoever wouldn't obey their rules and regulations, this is what would happen. So everybody had to come, Jews, non-Jews, everybody had to come there and see what they can do.
You saw this?
Yes, that I seen.
Do you know who they hung the first time?
No. We don't know who they did. When we came there, they already were hanging. I don't know when they did the hanging, but we had to go and see what they can do, which probably we knew anyways. And being in I would say that they marched in, and they came in September, right? And during the winter time, I think in November, whatever, they made us wear yellow bands to be recognized that we're Jews on the left or right arm. Especially at night, you couldn't go out at a certain time. You had to be in. And with having the yellow band, they would recognize who's the Jew walking where he should know. And then a couple of weeks later, they would make you wear a yellow star, the front, then in the back, you know, to recognize from the front or the back. And they would come in to streets and cut off certain sections, made everybody get out on the streets, and they would pick up people, they would take them away, and we never knew what took place with them, what would happen. They took them to labor. Some of them they took, which we found out later when we came to Auschwitz, that they took them to build all those crematoriums and the concentration camps. So before they enclosed the ghetto, which they brought everybody into this ghetto, this is what was going on from time to time. They would pick up people, beat them, or some of them kill. And like I said, they took some of them away, which we didn't know where they went.
So were you still living in the same apartment at this time?
Yes, we're still living at the same apartment.
Were you still going to school?
No, there was no school. School was interrupted right after. There was no schooling then anymore. And it took a while till they got all the people from Lodz, all the Jewish people together. They had an announcement made that by a certain time, everybody has to be out from all those buildings or homes or whatever, wherever they used to live in Lodz. And they all had to come in to the area in the ghetto, which they picked a section, which it was a nice size area there. You can visualize in Lodz, they had roughly, I would say, about 250,000 Jews living. So it wasn't just a few Jews. So it took a while for them to bring their stuff over to the area, and then they enclosed the ghetto, and that was in May 1940 they closed us in. You know, they came in 1939 in September. By 1940 they enclosed the ghetto, and that's when the real problem started.
How did they enclose it?
Well, they put up wired walls all around the whole section, what they picked as the ghetto. And matter of fact, they had a streetcar going between one of those main streets, which they had to have their transportation, not for us, but for themselves. For the people who lived in Lodz, for the Gentiles, and on their own. So they made sections like two walls in between where the streetcar would go, and over the walls they had a wooden bridge going, with stairs going up, going across, and then go down. And certain sections where they have those streetcars going, and like I said, it was a pretty big area. You know, they have to bring in 250,000 Jews, plus they brought in Jews from the smaller towns, the surroundings around Lodz. I really don't remember the sections, the provinces, which they don't ring a bell to me, but they brought them in from those areas. That was from the start. And being in the ghetto, the starvation was very tremendous. People were dying for hunger as it was going on. on the streets. That's like you would see the pictures they show the people in Africa, where they from the starvation, where they have those big bellies and skinny and dropping for hunger, and that's what took place in the lodge together too. But besides all that, we would they would come in, close up streets, made everybody go down in the yard or on the streets, and they would always take people away. And that was going on all through the years being in the ghetto. You were always living in fear. Besides being hungry, you had the fear with it. They wouldn't come in and beat you, but this is what they did. Some of them they probably did too.
But do you remember what streets bordered the ghetto?
There was many streets. One street, they picked, you know, certain main streets which they had those walls put up with barbed wires. They would have German soldiers concentrate, you know, walking around in those areas there. Main streets, I really don't recall any of the streets there where it would end. I would never go that far.
Who guarded the borders?
The borders the Germans did. The Germans guarded the borders. Besides all that, they had in the ghetto, they had a little ghetto built for the gypsies, which they also would go in at night, and we could hear the shots being fired to kill them out the same way.
Was there certain hours that you could leave the ghetto, in and out?
No, there was no such a thing as leave the ghetto. That once they enclosed the ghetto, you were there to die. Everybody had to work in order to get their ration food. We would stay in line days in and days out to get the little bit what it was supposed to be rationed to you. What else?
Were you still able to live in your same apartment?
Yeah, no, that we are able to live in the apartment.
Did anybody else have to move in with you?
There was uncle, actually another uncle, because he wasn't alive, but two cousins of ours, which one managed to go to Switzerland. From Switzerland, I'm talking about after the war, from Switzerland he went to Australia, which he passed away. So two of them were living with us at the time.
What kind of jobs did people have in the ghetto?
Whatever, everybody had to do something. There was no specified jobs. We did work. Most of them was working for the doing products for the military. They were building uniforms, shoes. They had the like. A market where they would bring in the vegetables, which it had to be given to the people, so people worked on those places, you know, to make sure that it's being given to the people. They would come, we would come there and stay in line and get with on the rations what we had to get your share, which it wasn't much.
Were there ration cards or anything?
Yeah, everybody had the ration cards.
Do you remember how much you got, or was it based on
remember.
Each person?
I don't remember what we had. Whatever we had wasn't enough.
And there was no school?
No.
No religious
there
school?
There was no school, nothing. There was not such a thing as a religious school. we would go to shul, pray from time to time. I mean, there, for the holidays, for sure we did. But we were already at the stage where, you know, things wasn't that important, but we still kept up the holiday prayers and the weekend prayers.
Did children play games in the ghetto?
Kids play games no matter under what conditions or where they at. You know, little kids, they don't know those things. That the struggle goes on.
You mentioned the gypsies. Did you encounter any of the gypsies? Did you speak
no,
with them?
No, we couldn't because they were in a separate little ghetto, which you wouldn't dare go there.
Was that walled off itself?
It was enclosed, walled out, yeah, by itself.
Within your ghetto?
With our ghetto.
Did you have any contact with the Judenrat in the ghetto?
Judenrat, what is the Judenrat?
Any different organizations in the ghetto that you spoke to?
No, as a youngster, I don't recall those things.
Were your mother and father
both? We really didn't know what was going on outside the world. There was no contact with anybody, and we didn't know what was going on. When those things happened, when they liquidated the ghetto at the time, when we came to Auschwitz, we were surprised that way we came into a place like that.
Were there Jewish police within the ghetto?
Yes, we had Jewish police. As a matter of fact, I almost forgot. While I was working with my brother and my cousin, going to the Polizei Presidium there, where we did that labor work for my father, they let him go from Russia. They had an announcement made, whoever wants to go back to Poland, they should register, because he was caught by them, by the Russians. Well, naturally, he had a family in Lodz, so he wanted to go back. So when he registered to go back, whoever registered to go back, they sent them through an area through Lublin, certain sections, they would kill some of them out. He happened to be one of the lucky ones, which he didn't. And as we went to work in to the Polizei Presidium there, we saw him walking on the street. Sort of, we were walking across each other, and that was the happiest moment of our life at that time, which myself and my brother were able to get a relief that day to go home and be with him for that day. Which, that, you know, that the guy who was in charge over there sort of knew us already, doing the work all day, and we told him, I don't know what made him being good-hearted, and he made us. He probably knew that eventually they're going to get rid of him too, of us. So that happened at that time. So of him being a soldier, when they organized police for keeping order in the ghetto, not right away, but to keep order in the ghetto, he was able to be a policeman.
Do you remember what
he had military upbringing a little bit, so he was sort of like a policeman.
Do you remember what date you saw him and he came back again? What month?
That was before they enclosed the ghetto. I don't remember exactly what month, but it was the early part of 40, 1940, early part.
So when they enclosed the ghetto, your whole family was together?
We were together, yeah.
And do you remember how many policemen there were, your father?
Oh,
yeah,
they had quite a bit, you know. There were quite a few policemen. You know, no matter what it is, you have to have a little order in whatever was going on. And with him being sort of having that police hat, saved one of my aunts, which she was put on a wagon to go probably to Auschwitz, we didn't know where. He was able to save her. He went sort of with that, following the track, the truck, and he managed to save her to bring her back. How he did it, I don't know, but she came back and she lasted a little bit longer. But it wasn't that much longer, but at least she stayed with us already another few months.
Do you remember what the uniform looked like? You talked about the hat.
No, it was just a police hat. I don't remember exactly what kind they had.
Who did those police report to? Or who supervised them?
That was the organizer, the guy who was in charge of the ghetto. His name was Chaim Rumkowski. He was like we'd say a president sort of, but which you know, he was the head of the ghetto. In other words, if the Germans would come in, he would have to give all the reports, or they would tell him what they want or whatever. And naturally, they had police, they had firemen or whatever, all Jews.
Were there certain rules?
It was like the ghetto was like a little town, you still had to have some kind of order.
Were there certain rules within the ghetto?
Now, what kind of rules could they have? Everybody was interested to have a meal in front of them, to have something to eat, so we did the best we could.
Do you know of anybody who was able to escape the ghetto or leave and come back?
No, there was no escape. I if there was one, you would have to crawl through like a mouse through, dig a hole and go through. You had the Germans in sections, being on top, and they observe who would try to escape or whatever, and they would walk and on the other side and control it. To escape from something like this, at least I don't know. I didn't hear of anybody.
When you said your aunt was saved, were there other relatives that you knew of who had been taken out?
In this situation, no.
And then when did things change after that?
When things changed, nothing changed. They had the Warsaw uprising. By being in ghetto, the struggle was every day in fear. That you didn't know when they're going to close up your place, your streets, and make you come down and take you away. That before the whole situation came, when they closed the ghetto because of the fear that the Warsaw ghetto had an uprising, which they were afraid that the same thing shouldn't happen in Lodz, so they started to liquidate the ghetto, and that created the end. That was the end of it.
Had you heard about the Warsaw uprising?
No, we didn't know nothing. We didn't know nothing. Like I said, we didn't have no outside contact whatsoever. I'm sure if we would have known what took place in Warsaw, or we would know that there is such existence as Auschwitz, I'm sure we would kill ourselves before getting to the place, or we would do something. Even we didn't have anything to fire with.
So what happened after the Warsaw Uprising? What started changing in your ghetto?
It wasn't changing. It was just, they just liquidated us. They came in with trucks, and they told us to take your belongings.
Do you remember when this was?
They closed the ghetto in 1944, or it was in September. I think roughly in September they closed the ghetto. But it took quite a few days to get everybody into the cattle wagons. So to take us to Auschwitz.
Did they make some kind of an announcement?
They didn't make no announcement. They just came to certain streets, blocked them off, and on the loud speakers, whatever, and they made tell everybody to go down, take your belongings. Don't take too much, but take your belongings with, and were going to a different place to work. They didn't say what. And so it took a while to get all the people out from the area. We came to the, I wouldn't say a station, I don't even remember. I remember the trains being there. We were brought there, put on the cattle trains. There wasn't, it's not a train, but you would say a train for traveling. It was strictly cattle trains with a small window, and piled in everybody with little belongings what he had with him. And in the center they had a pail standing where everybody would, I don't know if I should say it, piss and shit in the same area. And they dragged us to Auschwitz, not knowing that we're going to Auschwitz. We didn't know that Auschwitz is in existence.
Was your whole family on the same train?
The whole family was on the same train.
In the same car?
In the same car. And we weren't the last ones out at the time, because like I said, 250,000 Jews, a lot of them died before, but they always would bring in more Jews from different smaller towns or smaller cities, because Lodz was big and they were able to bring him in, because they died as fast as they brought him in from the hunger. So coming to Auschwitz, that's when we found out where we at, not knowing. The next morning we found out.
How many people were in the cattle car?
I would say each train, I know it was packed. I couldn't give you a number. How many would there be? Maybe, I don't know, 50, 60? There was no place to sit. It was all standing, leaning at each other. There was no... It wasn't a place where you sit down and take a train ride.
Okay, we'll continue in a second. Interviewing Joseph Morton. Before we continue on, I just wanted to ask you, did anybody in your family ever need any medical attention while you were back in the ghetto?
Matter of fact, I almost forgot about it. My little brother, he was maybe 4 years of age at that time.
Which brother?
His name was Jacob. He got sick and he needed medical care, and they're running a high fever. We were able to take him to the hospital, the children's hospital over there. I think it was on the street, it's called Zgierska. I don't know how to spell it anymore, but they had a children's hospital there. When they used to block off streets and take people away, at one time, they decided to take all the kids out from that hospital. My father and my brother, Abe, they found out, I don't remember where I was. They found out about it. They ran over to the hospital because they were taking kids down. I was told, now I didn't see it. I was told they were throwing down kids from the windows into the trucks to take him away, but they managed to get in into the hospital. They got him out, and from that time on they kept looking for him. I don't know how they got the names and everything, but they kept looking. We had to be in hiding for quite a while, every night in a different place, because the police came. The Germans, they came looking for him. I almost forgot to mention all that.
What was wrong with him?
Who knows? He was just running a high fever, and for some reason or another, we, we took him that time to the hospital, and he remained in the hospital. I guess they were trying to take care, and it didn't help.
And where did you start hiding? Different houses in
different,
the ghetto?
Different houses in the ghetto, you know. One night in this street, another street, you know, because we knew each other, you know. We managed to get through the night sleeping on the outside.
So your whole family would sleep in a different place each night?
The kids, the others were, sleeping with different families, but we with him would go, you know, in different areas.
And how long did this last?
It lasted a while, I don't know, a few days, and then afterwards it sort of cooled off, and then that was the end of it.
And then now getting back to when you were put on the cattle cars.
Oh, on the cattle cars.
Do you remember how many cars were attached on the train?
Oh, it was such a long procession of cars. Who knows how many cars there were? Who could look back? It was a long stretch, and they kept dragging us day in and day out, day in and night, and not knowing where we're going or where we're going to wind up. Then finally they came to the destination, to Auschwitz.
How long were you on the train, do you think?
I know we were there a few days.
Were you fed?
The only thing I remember, we only had is a little piece of bread there. Nobody was being fed.
So this is food you had brought with you?
Brought with.
What about water?
I don't even remember what we were drinking or whatever. I'm sure that there was some water probably in the pails of water which you were able to help yourself to have a drink.
Did anyone die on the train on the way over?
And not that I recall. I didn't see anything. But when we finally came to the place, to Auschwitz, which we didn't know where we at, they made us all go down, everybody. And whatever belongings they said we should take with, they said everything being left.
On the actual train, leave it?
On the cattle trains.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. The train stop at any time along the way?
They would stop, naturally they would stop. They kept going back and forth. We didn't know where we were going, so you can only look out through the little window and see the outside.
But you didn't get off the train at all?
No, are you kidding?
Did you see any townspeople?
Most of the trains, when they go during the daytime, they wouldn't stop. So when they stopped at night, they didn't open up. They just stopped, what can you see at night? During the daytime, when you drive through, you could see, you went through fields, maybe some little cities too. I was too little to reach the window.
So do you know if people saw the trains from the outside, townspeople?
Oh, I'm sure they did.
No interaction with them.
No, there's no. I'm sure that some of them must have seen that people are in those trains.
And you had no idea where you were going. They didn't tell you where you were going.
Absolutely not. No, they just said to us that we're going to different places. We're going to do work for them. We were in their hands, so who's there to ask questions?
So
there was nobody to ask questions.
What was the date that you arrived at Auschwitz?
We came to Auschwitz. What date was it? In 1944, was it September? Can I have a date? I want to.
Do you remember if you arrived in daytime or nighttime?
No, we came. Oh, hold on one second. In 1944, in August, we came to Auschwitz. And that was the end of the family when we came there. They made everybody go down from the trains. Sort of lined up all the way. And there were soldiers all over, plus the workers, what they worked for in camp there from Auschwitz, which they were in, the, in those particular commandos, sort of helping them, their organizing. They made people go left and right.
Who was giving the orders?
The Germans. They, whoever was in charge there at the time, I don't know their names.
Were they speaking German?
They speak in German. To go left, to go right, you know. And we didn't know what reason one left and one right. I guess at that time they picked whoever would be able for, to do some work for them, or whoever looked better to them. They kept you on the right side or left side, or whichever side was the good side for them. And it so happened that my family, I mean our family, my cousin and his family, you know, and the uncles, we happened to be all together, sort of. And they separated us, myself, my brother.
Which brother?
My father, myself, my brother, Abraham, the one who is alive, and my cousin, which he still lives in Toronto now.
What's his name?
Jacob Goldlust. We managed to be on sort of like you would say now, on the right side. And all the others, the younger ones, went with my mother, my cousins, you know, the girls, whatever, they went on the other side. And we didn't know what purpose, but after we got through with all that and they brought us into those huge barracks. Now, first they made everybody undress, and we all had the stripe, given the stripe uniform.
This is after you were already selected from the line?
After you got selected.
Did they ask you any questions when they were selecting
you? No, there was no questions asked. What
they didn't ask you how old you were?
No, they I don't think they would even bother with that.
So they just pointed one way or the other?
They pointed left, right. And we had to undress and put the stripe uniform on. You know what we were wearing, just a pair of pants and a top.
Did you say anything to the other people who were in the other line going the other way, or did you think you were seeing
them? No, we couldn't. We were taken away. They weren't taken away. We were taken away, whatever. And that was during the day, after we all got the uniforms, what the stripe uniforms, we came into at night. We were going through like sort of flame shooting from the areas there, and a lot of smoke. We didn't know what it is. But when we came into huge barrack, matter of fact, the barrack was tremendous, and the separation, the center of the barrack had sort of built a brick, like the chimneys are built going up, but this was a long bricks built. On the other side, they had a transport from the night before, laying already on the floor, being so huge, where they were laying, you know, head to head, feet to feet, must have been maybe across, I would say 6 or 8 across on the other half. And we were packed in like animals, and standing up, we couldn't even move. And they would have those capos. Capos are worked for the SS, and going around with bats and hitting over the heads to give out if anybody has hidden any gold, any diamonds, any gold in their teeth, or anybody's hiding anything, and just hitting. And that was going on for hours. Finally, we still didn't know where we at.
Were you still right next to your father and your brother?
We were all packed in. We could only go is from side to side. We were together, all of us. I'm talking about my father, myself, my brother, and my cousin. We managed to hold ourselves together, to stay in one place, but we figured whatever happened, wherever we're going to go, at least we have togetherness and we know from one another. The others, we didn't know what took place at the time. Till in the morning, after we went through all that, and if we finally were able to lay down and sort of get through the night. In the morning when we went out, which everybody went out from that particular place, they had different barracks. We ran into a lot of familiar faces, friends which we knew from before, you know, even being in the ghetto. And we ran into guys which they were taken away the early stage when the Germans came in, which we didn't know what they did with them, which they took him to build all those crematoriums and the concentration camps. So when we saw the people the next morning, we said, what is going on in here? So they said, you don't know what's going on. They told us, this is the place where they took away the family, they burned, gassed them. And they had the men's sections was separated from the women. On the other side, further distance, they had the women's sections. So we started to look because we didn't know when they said left, right, we didn't know what took with them. So we kept looking for my mother, for my aunts, for my cousins there to see if we could see anybody, which we weren't able to, because we found out what happened to the site which was left probably or whatever, that they would be in guessed. As far as being served food, I don't have to say anything about it because there wasn't that. They would give us a can, like a coffee can, for 3-4 people, which we would eat together out with it like an animal, worse than animal. They had their washrooms. I don't know if I could call it a washroom. It's dripping water, where you would have usually feed kettles, you know, and this is how you got your drinking water, or go to a washroom, the toilet, the outdoor plumbing. And that was going on for, I would say, maybe a week, two. Then they came. They would take away people for work to send away to Germany. Matter of fact, when we came, they didn't have a ready time because this was already 1944 in November, in September. And at that time, they stopped giving the numbers on the arms, which I'm glad, who needs it. They didn't have time to bother with it. They were being bombarded, they needed help to help them out, so they didn't want to bother with all that. But what they got is a number on the uniform. When they picked people to go to work, whoever found out that they're going to take some people to send to Germany to work, we were told, anytime you have a chance to get out from this area, from Auschwitz, go. No matter where, but go, because this is the end of the line. So everybody, whoever was going out for work, they would give us a number on the lapel from the stripe uniform, which I still have the number. I don't know if you're interested to get
what
to
was
give
your
you
number?
Number. I have it marked. Let's see if I have it marked down in here. I don't. I would have to look up and give you the number in between if you want to know the number. When they picked us, they took the amount of people into a big hall also, and they wanted to know how old you are. They checked you out, see the you had to undress, to check, see if you're qualified or if you're strong enough to do the work. And at the same time, we were lucky to get out my father, my brother, Abe, and my cousin Jacob, and myself. We were able to get out at the same time for work to Germany. And coming to Germany, they took us to a place which is Dachau. That's another concentration camp that's in Germany, because Auschwitz is actually in Poland. It's called Auschwitz, but this, they took us to Dachau. That's a camp, a working camp. They didn't gas over there, I don't think. I'm not sure, but I don't think they did any guessing.
Can you tell me, when did you leave Auschwitz?
Auschwitz, probably about 2 weeks after we got in there. So what was it? We didn't stay too long in Auschwitz, because we were trying to get out as fast as possible. And I would say about a couple of weeks.
Did you do anything during the day? Did they have you working?
No. There was no the over there. You didn't have to work.
You were just in the barracks all day.
The barracks outside. You know, like being in a prison. Being in a prison, it's just it wasn't a place for you to lay in a cot or something to sleep on. You were laying on a bare asphalt floor. Now, as far as when we came to Dachau, and Dachau is in Germany, from over there, they took us to Kaufering.
Let me back up. How did they get you from Auschwitz to Dachau?
We went by the same cattle trains as we arrived in Auschwitz.
Did they tell you where you were going?
We knew we were going to Germany for work. That's as far as we know. And arriving in Dachau, they stopped a distance from the place, and we marched over there. Coming to Dachau, that was like a stopover of just overnight. From over there, they had camps in the area, 11 camps, different sections, but it's in the vicinity. We happened to be left off in the camp in Kaufering, the lager, that's mean that particular camp, lager 4. And that's where we stayed there and worked.
What kind of work?
What kind of work? It was, I forgot to take the glasses off. Actually, we worked, I just marked myself while I remember it. It's not an easy name to remember. In Kaufering, we worked for the Hennenbach commando. The name is Betten and Moll commando. They were building, I know it was tremendous, deep down, I would say 10, 11 floors down. I really don't know what they were building. Probably they could have been building for certain like the atomic factories or whatever, I don't know. We used to carry bags of cement down. Ever so often they would take us to different areas to work, like working by the railroads after they got bombarded to fix all those things up, or we would work close to the airports. And besides all that, they would, being in this camp, that in Kaufering, in that particular camp, Lager 4, which they made you get up to count, see if everybody is in. The daylight wasn't even yet on. And that was during the winter time. Barefooted, we didn't have no shoes. If you had a piece or a sack from, you know, but you have the potato bags there with the see-through material rolled around your feet, and they would make us roll in the snow, tortured us before we're even able to get out to march to the positions to work where we would do the work. We used to go to work places where we would go, like I said, all kind of heavy work, carrying bags of cement to all these places.
Were you still wearing the same uniform you had
from
Auschwitz?
Uniform, yes. Yeah. Right, you think they would give you something to change? Are you kidding? You were lucky if you managed to hold on to that, because you know, if you lost your shoes or they got worn out, when we left Auschwitz, whoever didn't have the shoes, if somebody had a pair of good shoes, they would take it away from you and they would give you the wooden shoes, you know, the wooden canvas sort of with the wood underneath, and you know, that didn't last. And if you got rid of that, that's all you had to use, is a piece of sack rolled around your feet, and tried to manage through. And even going to work in Kaufering, like we went to farms, and if a farmer would have dropped a potato or a carrot or something, and if you would by chance saw it, you would pick it up, and if the soldier would have seen that you did that, he didn't have to do nothing, he just picked your number up. And coming back, they would stop, take you away from marching in, and they would take you in the washroom there, and they would put you down on a wooden horse, and you would get about 20, 25 leaks, and you were a goner almost. The next couple of days, you couldn't exist. You know, we were skin and bones. There wasn't much meat left on anybody at the time.
Were you or your father or your brother ever tortured or punished?
We tried to eliminate, not to pick anything up or get into that problem, because it wasn't a pleasant thing to get on your body, because you know, it wasn't worthwhile.
What happened from there? How long were you there?
We were in Kaufering, and over there we were about 2 months, I think. And from over there, they decided to organize another camp in Landshut. So they got together about 500 from all the different camps. You know, there was 11 camps over there. They took out a few from each camp, and they concentrated us in the lager, the camp 11. And they had 500 of us, and we went to Landshut.
Now, was this still with your brother and cousin and
yes,
father?
Yes, for some reason or another, we managed to hold ourselves together. Because when you always had somebody being in charge, let's see, in those barracks where we used to live in Kaufering, the living, it wasn't a regular normal barrack. It was a barrack deep down, about, I would say about 3-4 feet down in the ground. You had sort of a wood support, flat, straw, and this was your bed. Then they had the next top up, the same thing, built up with wood and put the straw on top, and we were laying. I don't know if you see maybe some pictures where guys of us laying and looking out after the war, to some of the pictures, what it showed, that was the barracks. That's how we lived. There wasn't a bed where you could go lay down, and it was filthy, full of lice. You know, worse than the monkeys do to each other. We were full of it, and this is the life what we went through. You know, just telling you all that, it's very difficult to describe the life what we went through. It was a torture. It was a very, very rough torture for everybody. I'm sure whoever went through, we all went through the same routine. and coming to from when they organized the group to come to Landshut with the 500. They happened to have a commandeer, a German assessment, but she was in charge of that camp. We were there, I would say, roughly a couple months. I don't know exactly how long in Landshut. About 6 weeks. They had to get rid of that camp because too many people were dying out. So being over there in Landshut, we would work, help build barracks for some of the SS soldiers, the one they wore the brown uniforms. And we worked with them. That was the work, what we did over there in Landshut. When they had to liquidate Landshut, they sent us to Mildorf. It was another camp.
How do you spell that?
Mildorf. It's a German spelling. Mulldrf. It was also not far from Munich, or I think that's where it comes out.
And okay. We'll finish up in a second.
Yeah, that's
I don't
okay.
want to interrupt. Joseph Morton, you had said before that you had your number from Auschwitz.
Yeah, I have to put my glasses on so I can give you my number. The number is 71324- now it's written a V and two lines, so not over a seven. That would be a seven, a Roman letter, five, and it's a seven, actually. And I think that's what it is. There is also 13526. I don't, that's what the number was given to me at the time.
And this was given to you?
That from Auschwitz when we left for work to Germany. And that number, normally I would have gotten on my arm at the time, which they read it was too late for them, too close for them to bother with it because conditions turned out to be sort of rough for themselves too. So,
how old were you at this time now?
Let's see. How old was I? My seventh grade at 39. I was in 44. I was born in 1924. So how old was I?
20 years old.
20 years old. 19 years old.
And when you went from these camps to camp with your father and brother and cousin, how was your physical condition?
That's what saved us. I happened to be pretty good. You know, my conditions was good. I was built pretty good. Where I was able to withheld all those rough times.
What about your father?
The same way. It looks like we're coming from a good breed, which was manageable, whatever they did to us, to exist. But then when we went to Mildorf, being there, I don't know if I mentioned it before, we worked to build the barracks there. But at that time, there was an epidemic, a typhus epidemic. I got sick, talking about being healthy. I got sick at the time, caught the typhus, running a high fever. And in that camp, they had a little separate sections where they put the sick ones in this particular place, but then they were getting too many of them Matter of fact, my brother Abe got sick a few days before I did on the typhus. But him being the youngest in that camp and being a short little guy, which we're not tall altogether, they sort of knew him as being the youngest in there. Germans who were watching the section from the sick camp into the regular camp sort of knew him a little bit. For some reason or another, he managed to go back into the barracks. And I, when I got sick, I was there maybe a day before he managed to get back. I got sick and I went in there and I kept looking for him and I couldn't find him. At that particular day, they decided to send all the sick ones from the camp there back to the place, to Carfring, where I used to be at one time, and coming from Dachau to Carfring. So they made a sick camp, that particular camp, Camp 4, which they made a sick camp, and we were brought there also by cattle train.
When was this?
That was in 44.
What month?
That was in 45, I'm sorry. 45. It was during the summertime. I don't even know what month. I know it was close to the liberation, because we could hear the planes going by and bombardments. So when they took us there to that sick camp, on the trains we would I would sit on guys who were dead, not knowing, till we came to the camp there, and they made us all go down. And I, at the time, I didn't know if my brother is there. I kept looking all over for him. I couldn't find him. I thought that he died from the sickness, from the typhus, because as it turned out, he managed to get back, but I didn't know anything about it. Coming to that camp, I ran into a fellow, which we were together right from the start when we came from Auschwitz to Kaufering. And he happened to remain there, because we were sent back to work in different camps, but he remained there. But when he saw me...
What was his name?
I don't know, Gary or something. I don't recall exactly. And he kept asking me about the rest of my, you know, my father, my brother, Abe, and my cousin, because he knew of us, because we were together. And I kept telling him that I can't find him. I looked all over for him between the sick ones, and I guess he must have gotten killed, or must have died. And I didn't know nothing about it. And that was going on for a while. I was getting sicker and sicker, running a high fever, no medication. That piece of bread what I had with me, I couldn't even eat because of all the high temperature. I needed this medication, which there was none. I had to crawl on my feet and my hand to the dripping, running water in the place where would call, you wash yourself around and you have a little water to drink. And that particular friend kept me encouraging. He says, Joe, hold back. It's coming to an end. It looks like we're going to be liberated soon. And I don't recall exactly how long it took. All of a sudden, they decided the Americans were coming in closer. So they had to run out, close up the camps and march different sections closer back. That's when we went to Allach. That was my last destination. But before going there, they would make you sort of undressed and walk by some of those soldiers who were in charge to see if we are able to walk, because it was a distance to march from one place to the other. I don't know with what strength I managed to go through, they accepted me to walk with them too, with the rest, whoever that, because I always knew, and they always would tell you, never remain with the sick ones, because whoever is not able to do anything for them, they kill. And as it turned out, when after we marched, after we got liberated, we found out whoever remained in that particular camp as a sick, they killed them all out. So that, anyways, we marched towards Allah.
How long was it?
Day two. It was a short period of time. It couldn't be more than 2-3 days, the most.
Were there men and women at this point, or were you separated?
No. There was no woman.
At that camp, there was no woman?
Any of the camps we were, there was no woman.
So after Auschwitz?
Only in Auschwitz, which they separated, they had kept women and men separated.
So after that, you didn't see any women?
After that, we were not, there was no woman. So when we came to Allah, again, I was on the bare floor, and I wasn't able to keep my eyes open anymore. I was skin and bone at the time. And finally, the moment came. We got liberated from the American army came in, and I was laying on the bare floor, and I only could see looking up. I saw a soldier standing above me. I couldn't tell who was who. I was already, I think if it would have lasted another day or two, I would have been a goner completely. And I was in no condition already to eat anything. When they saw me, the condition I am, they took us, whoever was in that same particular condition, and they took us to one of their hospitals in Allah. And from that time on, I didn't know where the rest of them are. My father, my brother, which I didn't know if he's still alive, and my cousin. Then being in Allah in that hospital, I guess I ran in to a neighbor's daughter from Europe, from Lodz, Poland. And that was already after we got liberated. I didn't enjoy the liberation because I was completely out.
Do you remember the date that your camp was liberated?
The liberation was, they were all in a day. It was, what, May the 30th or June the 1st. It was in a matter of a day.
Do you remember who liberated you? You said American.
Well, that was the American.
You know what division or anything?
It so happened I ran into a fellow soldier in the States here, which he happened to be in the area when he liberated us in that particular camp in Allah. Matter of fact, I got his name, and he also made me out an affidavit showing that he was one of the soldiers who liberated us from the Third Army. And while being in that sick camp, in that sick hospital, my neighbor's daughter saw me, and she moved around, so she went from one camp to the other to look, see if they find anybody in the family or friends or whatever, relatives. She ran into my brother and my father, and for me, I didn't know that he is alive. My brother. And I guess she told him that I'm alive, where I'm at. And my brother with a couple other guys got a hold of a military personnel with a jeep. They hitchhiked to the area where I was staying in a hospital. And he came over, and they got a hold of me without even checking out. We jumped the fence, and we went back to place where they stayed in Feldafing. That's near Starnberg, between Munich and I would say about 30 miles from Munich to this place. and that was a DP camp, because at that time I felt already a little better. I only needed this good food and to recuperate all the weight that I lost and so forth. And that was the almost till the end of when I left from Germany to Canada and from Canada to the United States.
You mentioned that she found your father and your brother. What about your cousin?
Yeah, he too. He was with them. They happened to be all right. They managed to go through that epidemic. They didn't get sick.
When you were in all these different camps...
That's why I lost my hair from all that.
When you were in all these camps, were there other people besides Jews that you knew of? Gypsies, Jehovah's Witnesses?
The only guys they had known Jews in those camps were guys who would be like criminals. They did some kind of criminology work, whatever. But other than that, mostly Jews. We were together with Jews from all different countries, Holland, Belgium, France, Italy, Czechoslovakians, from every part of Europe.
Any political prisoners in the camp that you knew of?
No. The only ones probably would have been, like they say, they would be in charge. In other words, they would carry out the work what the Germans wanted, like to look over us, to do the things what they want them to do.
Was there any form of resistance in any of the camps that you were in?
No. You could barely move. So what kind of resistance could you have? You were glad to be left, be as it is.
What were the food conditions after Auschwitz? You talked about in Auschwitz, in the other camps.
In the other camps, you would get rations. You know, like you get a piece of bread a certain amount a day, and you would get coming back. You would get some kind of a soup, and that's where you would get your ration, the bread with maybe a slice of bologna or whatever from time to time. It wasn't the greatest.
You said that
the torture was so tremendous in those camps. They like I said, they made you get up in the morning, roll in the coldest weather, stand on the appeal plots for the on the field on the camp there, sort of to count if you're all there. But it just kept going on and on. And God forbid if you would, like I said, if you would. Pick up something, to find a potato or carrot or anything, they would make a mess out of you. The next day you would be out.
You had said that someone mentioned to you they hear planes nearby, they think the end is coming.
Yeah.
Did you get any news from the outside of what was going on in the war?
No. There was no such a thing as getting news.
So your only indication was when you finally heard airplanes?
Then that's when we knew the bombardment and everything. We saw the places where I used to work before that they being bombarded, and we used to go and try to do the work for them, which they made you do it.
Was there any religious activity within these camps at all?
Oh no.
So there was no praying.
Nothing.
Do you remember?
They didn't let you do nothing.
Do you remember did you still pray to yourself? Did you still believe in God at the time?
Well, at that time, to be honest about it, I didn't anymore, because seeing all the torture that was going on, where is he? Enough is enough.
In Auschwitz, when they told you what had happened to your mother and all the other women...
That was the people who were there already a couple days before we came, they told us what took place, and we tried to look, seeing from a distance, seeing women and girls walking there, sort of, and they kept looking towards us, you know, shaved their hair off completely, see if we can see anybody, and, you know, couldn't find anybody.
Do you remember when what you thought when they said that they had been gassed? Did you even believe them?
We were right there afterward. After you're there a couple of days, so you know what's going on. So you know you believe it. Because you could smell it.
Do you remember what your father said to you?
What is it to say? We were just hoping maybe they, you know, somebody remained alive. Which one cousin, my cousin's sister, which she's alive. She's also in Toronto, and she went through the same thing what we did in Auschwitz.
When you were finally liberated, well, you were too sick. You don't know what happened to the Germans that were there.
No, I was out. I couldn't even if I wouldn't take any advantage. I didn't have the strength. I was out. I was almost blind. I couldn't see nothing. Well, I lifted up my eyes. I just saw as a soldier. I didn't know what kind of soldier about me, but I knew. We knew that there was we were liberated, and a lot of guys, from being undernourished, they were giving them food that was a little too rich. They got their stomach turned upside down. They couldn't take it. They died. A lot of them died from that. So in a way, it was a little bit of a blessing, which I wasn't able to eat at the time. They took me to the hospital. They recuperated a little bit. And as it turned out, when they found me, I didn't need any more medical attention. So we jumped the fence and that's it. You know, at that time, who obeyed the rules?
So take me back to the DP camp when you left there?
From the hospital, you mean?
Right.
Well, at that time there, we were there, we stayed in the barracks the food was decent. I managed to recuperate fast a little bit. I could see gaining weight a little bit, and after a while, maybe 6-7 months later, we were trying to do something. I went to work, sort of with some other guys. We went to work close by the area there where I stayed in Feldafing, in Starnberg. Worked with some of the American soldiers. They needed their jeeps or military trucks to be fixed. We were doing this kind of work, some of myself and some other guys.
And what was your father doing at the time?
No, nothing. Nothing.
And then what happened after that?
My brother, he, being an electrician over there, he learned also to fix electrical work. You know. So we're trying to get back to a sort of a normal procedure, you know, to do a little work and try to, for the future, to learn something.
Where did you go from there?
From over there, we registered actually to come to the United States because they came up with registrations to leave whoever wanted to come to the States. So. We registered to come to the United States, but it took a while. And, you know, sometimes it's not what you know, it's who you know. It didn't move that fast. So Canada came up, in which they took out some youth, young guys, girls, to Canada, in which I registered to that. And that came up first, and my brother and myself went to Canada, to Montreal.
Did you go back to your hometown at all after the war?
No, I didn't want to have nothing to do. I didn't want to look at it anymore.
Did you ever receive any official records of your mother and sisters and how they died, anything like that?
No, that we never got.
So what year did you leave to go to Canada?
I came to Canada in 1948. I think June the 1st, or around that time, in 1948.
Did you come with your father and brother?
No, just my brother.
What did your father do?
No, he was still in Germany. He came later to the States. So when he came to the States, while we were in Canada, As a rule, if you want to leave to the States from Canada as being a Polish-born citizen, I would have to register for a visa to go to the States. And also, they had rules: youngsters to family have a first privilege, which they don't have to wait that long. They don't have to go through a quota. At that time, they used to have quotas from each country to let in a certain amount. But since we were youngsters, it took only 3 months, 3 or 4 months, from Canada to come to the States. We were trying to stay together because, after nobody being alive, and we were one of the lucky ones, considered 1 in 1,000 to remain a father with 2 kids. So we were trying to stay together.
So when you came to Canada with your brother and your father stayed behind, was it because he couldn't go at the time?
At the time, no. He was registered to come to the States. They didn't take anybody out to Canada. They had a special from the Jewish Federation, I think. They were taking out some youngsters from Montreal, from Canada. I don't know if it's strictly Montreal, but the Canadian Jewish organization organized to get some of the youth out to Canada. And we registered, and that came about, and we managed to get here.
How did you get to Canada?
By boat, military boat. It took us, I think, about 7 days to travel. It wasn't the traveling like you travel now.
What were the conditions like on that boat?
It's a military ship, you're little bunkers. It's the way they were built at the time, but it was okay.
And
it was worthwhile.
Where did you go in Canada when you first arrived?
We came into Halifax by ship, and from over there they dropped off some in Halifax, some in Toronto, some in what other places do they have over there?
Where did you go?
We wound up in Montreal.
And what did you do when you arrived?
Over there, we just the first few couple of weeks, we sort of got used to it, enjoyed it a little bit. They fed us and they kept us in one particular place.
Who's they? Did you have a sponsor?
The Jewish Federation. They supported us at the time, and then they had people coming in, psychologists, and they tested you what your qualifications is. And after a couple of weeks, we were getting sort of jobs to learn a little trade or something. I wound up in the being a cutter in the needle industry. Well, now I'm cutting hair, so it's the same, just different cutting.
And how long did you stay in Canada?
In Canada, I left, I came in 1948, and I left, I think, in November 1949. I came to the States.
Where did you come to in the United States?
To Chicago, because my father was here.
He was in Chicago?
Oh, yeah, he was living in Chicago.
And did you come with your brother?
With my brother, right.
And your cousin?
No. My cousin he went back to Poland. He went back to Poland because his father, should rest in peace, he happened to be in Russia. As we start talking about it, things remind myself again. Now, when the Germans came in, a lot of people had a chance to run away from Poland, from Lodz, into Russia, like to Bergen, Bialystok. That's the Russian border. The borders were open. And whoever did escape at that time, which they let you out if you were smart enough to do it. Whoever did that, at least some of them remained alive. You bring up something like this, I remind myself again what took place. It's very hard to explain yourself with every detail from the start to the end. But the question is being asked something like that, you remember again what took place. You know, there is no end. Every time you would probably ask something else, I would have to go back again what we started with.
Okay, we'll continue in a second. Interviewing Joseph Morton. You said, what year did you come to the United States?
I came to the United States in 1948. November, I think. November 1948.
And did you move in with your father when you got here?
Yes, at that time I moved in with my father. They used to live in Chicago on Douglas Boulevard, if I remember correctly. At 3337 West Douglas Boulevard. You wouldn't want to go there now.
And you moved in with your brother and your father?
Yeah, we both came. We both came at the same time to the States from Montreal. And I met my wife to be at the time in Montreal, which. My father came once before to visit us. For him to come to Canada was okay, but I couldn't come from Canada to visit them in Montreal. I had to, in order to come, I would have to be a sort of a citizen. It wasn't like it's now, you know, you can go anywhere you want. So I met, they came, he came over, he met my wife at that time. We were going steady. And I guess when I came to Kent, to the States, I wanted to bring my wife, we weren't married at the time, to bring her over to be with me. So I had to go back and take out marriage license in Canada. And I brought her over in the matter of I think it took about 3 months.
So you actually got married in Canada?
According to the registration, the marriage license, we got it would be considered married in Canada, but the religious wedding was in Chicago in May in 1950, May 28th. I better mention the date.
Did you find out about any other surviving family members besides these three that
well,
you knew
we,
about
we
your
have,
cousin,
we
brother?
Have, no, we have quite a few fellas here who live here. We went through the same thing what we did.
Family members? Fact,
no, not family members. Friends, which we knew each other from before. Some of them from the same city, and some from different city. We worked together in those camps.
And you met up back here in Chicago?
Yes. Yeah. Listen, there were quite a few Jews from everywhere, and as little as there left, for some reason or another, we have managed to run into to each other from time to time.
Did you try to go to Palestine, or did you just want to go to Canada?
At that time, I wasn't trying to go to Palestine. We didn't have anybody at the time there, and. I don't know, the outlook was to go there, but at the time, right after the war, for some reason or another, we never concentrated on that trip, on that maneuver.
Did you feel any anti-Semitism when you got to Canada or the United States?
No, but when my brother got married, we had some family where my wife would stay in Montreal. They give her a place to live with them. She stayed in their house. So they were invited. That was my brother's wedding, and they happened to be in town. And right after my brother got married, my wife and myself, we and that, I think at that time we had my oldest son, and we took a trip to Albany, New York. My wife's aunt would live there, and uncle, her family side. So they were going, the ones from Montreal, where she used to stay in their place. The daughter was here, and she was driving back with her husband at that time. I think she was married. Yeah. Back to Montreal, and we happened to go through her father from Canada, where she stayed, was staying at the Catskill Mountains.
Catskills.
So we were driving through, and she didn't know exactly where the place is, and we made a stop. She saw a decent hotel, and she walked over to try to find out if their father is staying there. I guess it happened to be a country club or whatever, and there was a sign, no Jews, no dogs, or no colored allowed. When she came back to the car for us to continue go further because it wasn't the right place, and she told me what she saw the sign, I says, I couldn't believe it. That was my first incident at that time. That was what then? When did he get married? 53 or something, whatever. That was my first surprise of anti-Semitism in the States, that something like this exists. It was a shock to me at the time. But at that time, I just didn't know what to say.
What was the Jewish community like in Chicago when you moved here?
It was okay, especially around the West Side and Douglas, Independence. As a matter of fact, after we got married, we lived in the areas there.
Did you start going to synagogue again?
We didn't belong officially into a synagogue, but for the holidays, for the high holidays, we went. Like I said, my belief changed a little bit at that time. From Orthodox, I turned conservative, so I wasn't, sitting on that particular issue that well. I just went because being used to it, to go for the high holidays and on Saturdays, whatever, sometimes.
Did your belief in God change over the years after the war?
Well, there's always a belief. You always say God's willing or whatever, but I don't know what to say on that situation.
Why do you think you survived?
By luck. Strictly luck. There's no other thing. It's strictly luck, and managed to stay out of problems where you don't get hit or beaten.
Did you have children?
When?
With your wife after.
Oh, now, yeah, of course.
How many children?
We had three kids, two boys and a girl.
What are their names?
Leo, Dan, that's the oldest, Fred, Morton, and Ann Gail.
And do you have any grandchildren?
Yeah, we have five of them. Jeremy, the oldest, he's roughly about 18. Then my granddaughter, Amanda, is, I would say, roughly close to 16. And then my daughter has three of them, two boys and a girl. Their ages, roughly from 10 or 10 and a half, and 7 and 5.
What are their names?
Their names are Michael is the oldest, Carly, that's the girl, she's the middle, and then we have Brandon, he's the youngest. And their name is Olive, just in case if you want.
Did you ever talk to your children about your experiences?
Very, very little. Till after they showed that movie Shoah, they started to be after us because they knew what we went through, and so they wanted to know the real story, what took place with us. So that's when they were starting to bother us. And finally, I finally give up, and I said, well, I have to do it. I didn't want to, till this day, I still get nightmares where I can't believe I'm here, or it's things which it isn't pleasant, and I didn't want to discuss things between them to get nightmares into them, which I think it was wrong. But finally, I decided I got to do it. We're not getting any younger. It looks like most of us, the ones who remain alive, most of them are disappearing. They're shrinking.
What effect do you think this has had on your life and how you've raised your kids?
I think we raised them pretty good. They're all, like they say, good mention. They're okay. At least in my book, have no problems.
After you got married, what job did you have?
I worked as a cutter in Montreal. I learned the trade. Then when I came here, I continued that for a while, and then I finally went into barbering, men's hairstyling, men's cutting.
And how long have you been doing that?
Oh, I would say since in the 60s, 65.
Was your wife a Holocaust survivor?
Yes.
But you didn't know her back then? In Poland?
I met her in Montreal. And when I met her, I knew what she went through also, but she was also a Holocaust survivor in a different way.
What's your attitude now towards Poland?
Not great. Actually, they don't exist. They did too many bad things to our people, which I have no desire to talk about them or even to go visit them again or whatever.
Did you apply for restitution?
Yes, I did.
What happened?
I get monthly restitution payment, the minimum, whatever it was assigned to.
What's your attitude today towards non-Jews in general?
No, I don't discriminate anybody. With the Poles, whatever. As a youngster, I know what we went through with them, so my feeling toward them is sort of cool. I just have no desire to get together with them, or I stopped even using their language. I used to know more than I know now the language because of not being used. I dislike them.
Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No. There isn't much I could add. I just hope that those things never happen and nobody has to go through what we went through, and special in our Jewish conditions, you know, where we don't have to go through anymore those problems.
Anything else you'd like to add for future generations?
Future generations?
Any message to them,
live grandchildren? Live it up and have a good, healthy life, and enjoy life, because life is too short. Got to make the best of it. Because we know, whatever we had disappeared, and you can't bring it back. So you have to do the best you can and enjoy it and live it up.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Now this picture is my mother. Her name is Ziesel Goldring, my maiden name, married to my father, Mortkowitz. And that picture was taken, I was about a year old, I would say 1925, in Lodz, Poland.
And how did you get this picture?
That picture was sent to me from Argentina, from Buenos Aires. I guess they must have sent it at the time when, you know, I was born, and they sent them a picture of us. Now, this is actually the original picture, what I showed you before, that's with me, but it was taken in 1925. That's the original picture sent to Argentina. And my name, my mother's name again, is Zisla Golding. And this is, and she's holding me, I was about a year old. Now, this picture you're looking at was taken in Germany in 1946. Was working at the time in the military auto repair shop, where we would help repair the jeeps and the military trucks. And I'm sitting from the left. I'm sitting down on the left. A friend of mine, which they're all actually friends, but his name I still remember. His name was Sulik. He was also in Chicago. He died already.
How did you get this picture?
That picture was taken in Germany, which I had it with me.
Don't move around there.
Now this picture was taken in Germany in 1946. On the left is my brother Abe Abram Mordkowitz, now it's Morton, and I'm next to him, and that's me, Joe Morton. And my brother now lives, he used to live in Chicago, in Skokie, and now he lives in Vegas. Now this picture, as you can see, I got married at the time to my lovely wife, Janet Sonnenblick, her maiden name, and now she is Morton. I'm sure you recognize myself on the left, and on next to her, the right, is my father, Haskell Mordkowitz. And that picture was taken in Chicago when we got married in May 28th, 1950. You never know who you run into. I happened to be working in the needle industry as a cutter, and I ran into one of the fellows who worked there. We were talking about the situation, the way I got liberated, and I happened to mention that I was in Mildorf. So he says, well, I'm the one who actually liberated you guys. I am one of the first ones to come to Mildorf, and I was in the Third Army as a tank battalion. And like I said, I was like he told me, he was the one who liberated it. So I wanted to have sort of a statement, which he made it for me in September 25, 1962, in Chicago.
You mentioned something about your physical condition.
Oh yes, he also remembers picking us up, being sick like this, and at the same time, I was kicked from one of the soldiers with a bayonet on my right buttock. What you'd say? Matter of fact, I got two wounds yet left. So we marched from Kaufering to Mildorf at the time. That was close toward the end. So when they came to liberate us, they found me on the bare floor laying with the wound, and that's how I wound up in the hospital too, with all that, the typhus and the wound. By now it's healed. Now that picture was taken on my granddaughter's bat mitzvah. Now, from the left, sitting down, he is standing actually next to my sitting down son. His name is Michael Olive. He's about 7 years old at the time. And next to him is my son sitting down, Dr. Leo Morton. And next to him is Cheryl Morton. Her maiden name is Cheryl Quaid. And next to my daughter-in-law is my lovely wife, Janet Morton. And next to her, it's me sitting down, which I think by now you know my name, Joseph Morton. And next to me is my granddaughter, standing, Carly Olive. She must be about 5 years old at the time. And going up from the right, my daughter, Ann Olive, her maiden name is Morton, holding my grandson, the youngest, Jeremy,
Brendan.
And he is about over there, I would say, what, 3 years old, 2.5. And next to her is her husband, Lane Olive. And next to him is my oldest grandson, Jeremy Morton. And next to him is my granddaughter, his sister, Amanda Morton. And next to her, last is my middle son, Fred Morton.
Would you introduce us?
Again? This is my lovely wife, Janet Morton. Her maiden name is Janet Sonnenblick. And this is the girl I met in Montreal, which I got married to her. And what else is to say? And she's a lovely girl. I like her very much. And we're married already, it's going to be about 47 years. And hopefully continue a little longer.
Is there anything you'd like to say?
Yeah, the same thing. Very happy together. I'm happy I met him in Montreal. And
we have a good life
together, have lovely children, devoted, and grandchildren. And we're just happy that we made it and we had another chance.
Is there anything else you'd like to say to your children and grandchildren?
I really don't know what else is to say.
We hope they don't have to go through what we did in the future. And
that's exactly what I said. That's about it. I mean, what can we say?
Okay. Yeah? Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.